Thank you, Niger, for the kind presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. The topic of this lecture is about a plausible common origin of metabolism and genetics in the cell. In this slide is described a very simplified scheme of the system chemistry that occurs present day in the cell. In a conventional way, we can divide all chemical transformations into two big boxes that are the metabolism box and the genetic box. Metabolism is essential to produce the chemical energy for the cell and organics, while genetic is involved in the transfer of heredity during cell replication. We are interested to evaluate if these two big transformations in the cell can originate in a similar way. This is an interesting point from a prebiotic point of view, and in general, if we analyze the different theories about the origin of organics in the primitive Earth or elsewhere in the universe, we have two kinds of big scenarios. One scenario is about the origin of the genetic apparatus, for example, the hydrogen cyanide chemistry and the formamide chemistry that can yield mainly nucleic acid bases and amino acids. And the other possibility is the origin of an intermediate of metabolism, for example, carboxylic acid that have been synthesized in the Waghäuser model. We are interested to develop some prebiotic model during which both intermediates of genetic and metabolism can be easily synthesized. And in a general approach, this is a scheme for a prebiotic process, we need to define the reagent, the starting material for this transformation. We need to define the energy source and also the physical and chemical properties of the environment in which these transformations can occur. And one interesting, in my opinion, chemical precursor for this kind of transformations is formamide. Formamide is the simplest amide in nature. It has been detected in different bodies in the universe, like comets, asteroids, and others. And from a chemical point of view, formamide can be easily synthesized under phase conditions, for example, under proton irradiation, UV irradiation, or of high pyrolytic processes, or can be also produced in terrestrial conditions, for example, by hydrolysis of hydrogen cyanide or by other chemical transformations. One produced formamide can directly polymerize to biomolecules, as I will show you in the next, or it can be in part degraded to other low molecular weight compounds that are all useful intermediates for the synthesis of biomolecules. And I will show you some examples about these possibility, and pioneering studies by Koyama and Yamada showed that heating formamide at 160 degrees is possible to obtain purine. Purine is not so interesting as a biomolecule, but performing the reaction in the presence of adenine cyanide, also adenine can be synthesized. Adenine is a present day nucleic acid base. The problem is that under this experimental condition, the yield of adenine is very low. And then we need to perform this kind of transformation under catalytic conditions. And minerals or metal oxides can perform as a catalyst for this kind of transformation. And in the past, we showed that several minerals and metal oxides effectively can catalyze the polymerization of a formamide to a large number of biomolecules like nucleic acid bases, including nucleotides, oligonucleotides. Minerals can perform phosphorylation processes. Polymerization of simple monomers to polymers, and also they can catalyze the formation of micelles as the first example of a cellular membrane. Well, about minerals, non-terrestrial compounds can also perform as a catalyst, and we were known that meteorites or asteroids contain organics in their structure. For example, amino acids can be detected in meteorites, and this means that there is a correlation between this kind of minerals and the organics that we need for the lab. And in some studies, we demonstrated, for example, that cosmic dust analogues can perform as catalysts for the synthesis of biomolecules. A cosmic dust analogues can be produced in the lab by some laser ablation technique. And they can be produced with a specific elemental composition. That means that we can control the amount of iron or magnesium in this compound. And if we heat from a mite at 160 degrees in the presence of cosmic dust analogues with a different iron and magnesium composition, we can synthesize, for example, some pyrimidine nucleic acid bases like cytosine and uracil. This is an interesting chemistry. We can analyze the mechanism of this transformation by means of some specific analytical technique. And analyzing this mechanism, we can observe that not only formamide is involved in this kind of transformation, but also hydrogen cyanide that is produced in situ by formamide degradation. The yields are very interesting, and it's also interesting to note that the yield of nucleic bases depends on the amount of iron in the catalyst. For example, the yield of cytosine is highest in the presence of a large amount of iron as for thiolate. Well, nucleic acid bases are component of the genetic apparatus, but we are also interested to evaluate the possibility to synthesize organics that are involved in metabolism. One possible example regarding formamide chemistry is that of borate. There are different mineral borates. These are ancient mineral in the earth. And there is a connection between the chemistry of borate and the chemistry of formamide. And in fact, formamide on the Earth is easily produced from hydrogen cyanide under hydrolytic conditions, and in the same conditions, fixed borates can be solubilized to yield dissolved minerals that effectively can act as a catalyst. We can study a large panel of borates to evaluate their catalytic efficiency. And as you can see, when borates are used as a catalyst, it's possible to synthesize not only nucleic acid bases like cytosine and adenine, and then compounds that are correlated to the genetic apparatus, but we can also synthesize carboxylic acids. Carboxylic acids like pyruvic acid or lactic acid, glycolic acid, which are in a some way connected with metabolism, for example, with glycogenesis and other metabolic cycles. Well, is it possible to obtain carboxylic acids from formamide? Albert Edelmoser suggested some times ago that the way to produce carboxylic acids from formamide is correlated to the formation of hydrogen cyanide dimer and hydrogen cyanide tetramer. Then again, there is a complex and multifunctional chemistry than which not only formamide but also other reactive intermediates can participate in this synthesis. Another example is that of titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide is widely diffused in the universe, and in this case we use titanium dioxide in the anaphase phase, and under thermal conditions, from formamide, it's possible to synthesize adenine, cytosine, thymine, and some isaclonucleosides that are a more complex structure similar to nucleosides in the cell. Regarding the way for the formation of this compound, this is the case of thymine, the reaction requires formaldehyde. Formaldehyde, this compound, is reactive into this position, the electrophilic position. Formaldehyde can add to the carbon 5 position of a preformed uracil to yield 5 hydroxymethyl uracil. This compound has been detected in the reaction medium. 5-hydroxymethyl uracil can form an ester with formic acid, again generated in situ, and this ester can rearrange to yield thymine. This is a one-pot domino transformation. That means that all these steps are contemporarily produced during the reaction. Formaldehyde is an interesting compound because it is the substrate for the Formose condensation, the reaction during which different sugars can be synthesized under prebiotic conditions. And in our case, the presence of formaldehyde justifies the possibility to grow a sugar-like side chain in the case of nucleoside analysis, because formaldehyde in this activated form can add on a formulated purine base to grow step by step the side chain, thus mimicking the synthesis of a sugar bonded to the nucleic acid base. and occurs in nucleocytes. Well, former mind can produce a lot of compounds required for the origin of DNA and RNA, but we are also interested to understand if experimental conditions exist to synthesize intermediates for the metabolism. And I will start from this specific example. This is the citric acid cycle. The citric acid cycle is one of the most ancient cycles in the metabolism, during which carboxylic acids are converted each other to yield chemical energy, amino acids, nucleic acid bases, and also sugar and lipids. In the present day, the cycle is a right clutch, and it requires oxygen to work. Obviously, oxygen was not present in the primitive atmosphere. This is the present day knowledge. And then, to work in the primitive Earth, this cycle required to work in an anti-clock way. Under these conditions, only carbon dioxide is required to transform any intermediate in the other. Well, we can synthesize these compounds, carboxylic acid intermediate of the citric acid cycle, by using titanium dioxide as a photocatalyst. In fact, if we irradiate titanium dioxide in the anatase or eukaryotic form, it can be excited, and when excited in the presence of formamide, it's possible to generate some reactive intermediate that can further polymerize to yield organics. This study was first reported by Senayake and Ivis, which photoirradiated formamide in the presence of titanium dioxide, showing the possibility to synthesize nucleic acid bases. On the other hand, the nucleic acid bases were detected eating the crop. And in our opinion, this was a thermal condensation, not a photochemical process. And for this reason, we decided to repeat the experiment under photochemical conditions using a synchrotron light as an energy source. And in these experimental conditions, only intermediates of the metabolism are synthesized, and nucleic acid bases are not observed. The reaction mechanism is completely different from that observed for the thermal condensation. And during irradiation, CERT is produced hydrogen cyanide. Hydrogen cyanide can be further transformed in the hydrogen cyanide tetramer. And this tetramer can be subjected to hydrolytic processes and then to redox processes to yield all the carboxylic acids that we detected. The yield of these compounds are very high for a prebiotic process, and it is very interesting to note that 6 of the 11 intermediates of the citric acid cycle can be contemporary synthesized. Then this is a smallest cycle that can work in a autocell way. I will finish this lecture showing you some other possibilities about meteorites. These are two meteorites of the chondrite family, the Murchison and Orway meteorite. And the dust of this meteorite can be effectively used as a catalyst for the synthesis of biomolecules from formamide. And when formamide was treated under thermal conditions in the presence of Murchison dust, nucleic acid bases, carboxylic acid, and amino acids can be contemporary synthesized. Thus, experimental conditions exist during which all intermediates of the metabolism and the genetic apparatus can be contemporary synthesized. Another interesting point in this synthesis is the presence of amino acids like glycine and of formulated amino acids. The presence of formulated amino acids is an interesting example of an abiotic peptidase in the sense that one produces glycine, it can be activated by formamide through formation of this compound, which name is carbodimide. Carbodimide is a non-condensing agent for amino acid. It can react with glycine, activating the formation of a peptide-like bond. This means that in the presence of a meteorite, not only is possible the synthesis of amino acids, but also the synthesis of the peptide bond that is the step necessary for increasing the structural complexity of the polymer. The Orgay meteorite works in a similar way. That means that is a general trend for meteorites to catalyze the synthesis of biomolecules like biogenic carboxylic acids, including the acids involved in the citric acid cycle. I change fast the slide just to show you that it's possible to synthesize not only natural amino acids like glycine, but also unnatural amino acids, isovalin and others. These compounds are usually used as a marker for the extraterrestrial origin in meteorites of this kind of compound, and the formamide model can justify the synthesis of these compounds. In this table is compared the amount of unnatural amino acids that can be synthesized from formamide and Murchison, and that detected in the original meteorite. As you can see, the yield of this compound starting from formamide is higher than that relative to the compound already present in meteorite, and this means that obviously in the lab conditions the prebiotic synthesis are optimized with respect to the prebiotic processes that can occur in the space. Iron meteorites work in a similar way. This is the case of three iron meteorites, Campo del Cielo, Sicotelin, and Canyon Diablo. And these compounds, for example, are very efficient for the synthesis of amino acids and carboxylic acid. And you can see a very large panel of terrestrial and non-terrestrial amino acids can be synthesized using iron meteorites as a catalyst for amide condensation. And the same is true for carboxylic acid. Malonic acid, pyruvic acid, succinic acid, and maleic acid, different other acids can be easily synthesized under these experimental conditions. This is just to show you that the different meteorites show a different selectivity in terms of yield for for the families of organics like purines, pyrimidines, amino acids, and carboxylic acids. And this is just to show you all compounds that can be synthesized contemporaneously from formamide and minerals, and the present-day biogenic pathways that are connected with these specific compounds, like glycolysis and gluconeogenesis, the citric acid cycle, as I show you previously, glycosylic acid cycle, the synthesis of amino acids, the synthesis of nucleic acid bases, and the synthesis of phospholipids. All these biogenic pathways that work present day in the cell can be mimicked, can be probed by formamide chemistry and terrestrial and non-terrestrial minerals. This is just to remember the most important researchers that work in the field of prebiotic chemistry, and I finish my presentation. Obviously, I am interested to listen if there are questions about the possibility of contemporary synthesized intermediates for both metabolism and genetic apparatuses. Thank you very much.
Yes, I have a question. Just, sorry. First of all, I'm sorry. I have a question to Raffaele concerning the other ingredients that generated the thymine or the other simple the other ingredients of DNA and of proteins. So what is the influence of the atmosphere, and what is the influence of pressure? Because here we have seen that to catalyze the reactions, important are rocks, of course, water. We have seen also the radiation. But what about these other two factors, the pressure and atmosphere?
Okay. I usually in this model we work in terrestrial light conditions, or eventually when there are irradiation study under vacuum, depending on the specific model that we are interested to study. But from a general point of view, the composition of the atmosphere is very important because there are equilibrium between the components in the atmosphere and water, if there is water, or also the surface of the mineral, if there is not water, or there is ice, or some other compound. I show you the case of the citric acid cycle as an example of your question, because this cycle work in a different way depending on the composition of the atmosphere. It works clock-like or anti-clock-like-wise if there is oxygen or carbon dioxide. Well, from this point of view, there are some really interesting studies about the possibility to use carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide as a component in the atmosphere for the synthesis of biogenic carboxylic acid. These studies are usually performed using iron nickel sulfide as a catalyst, and is really interesting because we can directly fix the component of the atmosphere into organics with a relatively complex structure. This is a very interesting point. About the pressure, okay, there are two different scenarios. One is about low pressure. In my opinion, under these conditions are very interesting the process that can be occur on the surface of the mineral. The other scenario is very high pressure, as for example in the black smoke, where the compound are the reactivity of compound is really increased by the high temperature that is obviously occur. I don't know if it's complete my answer, is, but it is just an idea to answer you.
Frank, does that answer your question?
Yes, very well. So I thank you, Raffaele, for the nice talk. I think we have no other questions. Greeting from Szczecin to everybody.
Okay.
Thank you very much once again, Raffaele.
Thank you.
Much appreciated.
Bye.